हेलो गाइस, वेलकम ऑल टू दिस सेशन ऑफ ईएनटी। I hope that audio is okay. So I'm going to run this session in 2-3 parts, where I'm going to show you all the important ENT measures targeting NEET PG 2021. And the aim is simple, that I want to show you all the images just in 2 or 3 sessions of half an hour each. And I'm pretty sure that these sessions will take care of all your ENT images. You'll not have to go anywhere else to look for the images. Along with the images, of course, I'm also going to tell you the main points about each of those conditions. So let's begin right away. I'm your ENT faculty and educator, Dr. Sanjay Agarwal. I've done my ENT from Delhi, and I've been teaching for 20 years. So that's a huge experience I have. So let's start with the first question. Now, basically it's about this tube. We have to identify this tube. This question was asked, this image-based question was asked last year in NEET PG. It's a very important image, and they can ask you related images. So you have to be aware of this. The name of this instrument is the purple one. Of course, the white thing is the Eustachian tube. You know that. Look at the top image. It's a Passe-Muir valve. It's a kind of diaphragm, you know, that's attached to the tracheostomy tube. If you look at the lower diagram, it is attached to the tracheostomy, the way it is done. And as it says, it is a one-way valve. You can only breathe in through it, inspired. You cannot breathe out of this. So what happens is, if somebody has a difficulty in breathing and you do tracheostomy with normal larynx, this is a tracheostomy with normal larynx, where the larynx can be used. If you do a tracheostomy in a patient, and even if the larynx is normal, this patient cannot speak, because for speech, the larynx has to go through the larynx, the air has to pass through the larynx. And that's why, but in a tracheostomy patient, the air goes in and out through the tube, this tracheostomy tube. So the person cannot speak even if the larynx is good. So if you do a tracheostomy and the patient has a normal larynx, want to speak, then you can use this Passe-Muir valve. So this allows, as it says, one-way valve. It only allows to breathe in. But when the patient is breathing out, the air cannot go. So the air leaks from the side, and that air passes through the larynx, and the vocal cord starts vibrating, and the voice can be produced. So this is what it says, the third sentence. It assists in speech production in patient with tracheostomy. And you can add that tracheostomy with normal larynx. The larynx has to be normal. That's a prerequisite for this one. That's an essential criteria. So this tube and the other tubes which are used for speech rehabilitation, which are placed in the tracheoesophageal fistula, those tubes you should also be able to recognize. One name is Passe, one is called Panje, not Passe, Panje, one is Blomsinger. So in my future sessions, which is going to continue with this, I'm going to show you all those images also. Next image. Just identify what sign is this. It's a very popular disease, very common disease. They will never ask you just like way I've shown. They will never ask you a spot diagnosis. They'll show the image and ask you the diagnosis. But because this session is about images only, so I'm not going to put on a question. But in all likelihood, if they ask you a question in the exam, it's going to be an image plus a proper question. They're going to give a history, a little bit, a child with ear pain, hearing loss in 3 days. And the otoscopy, this is the otoscopy finding. I'm sure you know, normally the tympanic membrane is pearly white. And here the tympanic membrane is not pearly white, it is slightly more congested. And because it's congested, you can see the capillaries, the dilated capillaries running radially from the center, it is running outwards radially like this. These are the capillaries. Can you see this capillary running radially? And this handle of malleus is also congested. It's congested very deeply. And so if I give you these leads, everybody knows that this is a cartwheel appearance. This finding is described as cartwheel appearance. And the condition is ASM, acute superative otitis media. So that's why I said an acute superative otitis media, ASM, is usually a child. It can happen in adult also, so usually a child, and there's pain with hearing loss. Now, pain in ASM is the predominant symptom. That's why I said when they give you this image, they'll definitely give you a history where the patient has pain, hearing loss, and this finding. And then straight away, ASUM, acute superior otitis media. They may ask you this finding or sign, which is cartwheel appearance, as I said. The other important signs in this ASUM is, one is, as I said, lighthouse sign, one is reservoir sign. These two signs are also very, very commonly asked MCQs. The other findings image in this could be a bulging membrane, and they could show you an image with the fluid inside. Fluid level is seen, as we call it. So fluid in the middle ear can also be shown in one of the images, and they can ask you questions on that. So ASUM, blue ear, which is SUM, safe CSUM, unsafe CSUM, tubercular otitis media, mastoiditis. In mastoiditis, there is ironed out mastoid. Mastoiditis also has these two signs. These two signs are seen in ASUM as well as mastoiditis. And what is interesting, suppose they ask you lighthouse sign is seen in which of the following condition? And you all know lighthouse sign is seen in ASM as well as mastoiditis. The better answer is ASM for lighthouse. Okay. So you have to pick from one of the two, you have to pick ASM. But for reservoir sign, the reverse is true. If they ask you reservoir sign is seen in which of the following condition, and both are given in the choices, and you have to pick one, then you have to pick mastoiditis. So that's a very interesting thing. For lighthouse sign, ASM is a better answer. For reservoir sign, mastoiditis is a better answer. So these are little nuggets that you should know, and we often get trapped in this kind of simple things that they ask in the exam. So please be aware of these simple things. Next question. What is this procedure? Look at this image and try to find out what procedure is being done. I'll give you a little bit of hint that you can make out that this is ear. You can see the external ear, tympanic membrane, middle ear. You can see the ossicles in the middle ear. And you can see the inner ear also, and the eighth nerve supplying the inner ear. And you can see that's a tube, small catheter kind of thing, passing through the tympanic membrane and going in the middle ear. So try and identify this image. And to give you a little more lead, you can see the stapes. You can see the stapes, which is here. So that's the oval window, because stapes ends in the oval window. So this tube is ending below this oval window, and this window where the tube is ending has to be a round window. So it is ending in the round window. This is the eustachian tube. So with this much of lead, I'm sure you're able to come to a conclusion as to what condition is this. Yeah, this is called Mikrowicz microcatheter at the round window. So this is a procedure. This tube is called Mikrowicz microcatheter, and it ends at the round window, as you can see. I just gave you the hint also. And inside this, there is a gentamicin. So this is used to supply the gentamicin to the round window. And this is used in two diseases. It is used for Meniere's disease, which we all know it's a very common disease, but it's also used for BPPV. In BPPV also, we may use this. So what you do is, this tube is like, it's going to soak if you give drops of gentamicin. You don't have to fill in also. The Mikrowicz microcatheter where you fill in the gentamicin and place at the round window. But here, what you can do is, you can give drops of that every now and then, every day, twice a day, maybe once a day. You give gentamicin drop, and the gentamicin will travel through this tube and go through the round window in the inner ear and damage the vestibule. And this process is called a medical vestibulectomy. Medical because medicine is used, gentamicin, and vestibulectomy because a vestibule is damaged. Because gentamicin is a vestibulotoxic drug. That's a very important thing. Gentamicin is a vestibulotoxic drug, and that's why it is used. So you have to do a small surgery procedure to place this microthick catheter through this tympanic membrane. This particular instrument is called silver stain tube. The name of this is silver stain tube. It's a type of microcatheter, as we call it. This question was asked 4 or 5 years back. Without the image, they'd asked that Microwick's microcatheter is placed where? That was the question. Microwick's microcatheter is placed at the round window. This was the question. And why at the round window? Because round window is the only part which has a membrane called secondary tympanic membrane. Rest of the boundary of the ear between the middle and the in all this boundary, see, all this boundary between the middle ear and the inner ear is bony boundary. So nothing can travel through the bone. But here you have the membrane in the round window. And so through the membrane, it can go via a process called endocytosis. The process which is used by the gentamicin to travel from the middle ear to the inner ear through the round window is called endocytosis. So this is another important thing that you might want to remember. So keep that in mind, please. Next question. This is very simple. It's a very, very profound, important question. Identify the arrow mark structure. So I'll give you a few seconds to identify, in case. I think this is straight away most African diagnosed, but these are very, very popular questions, very commonly asked, either with image or without image. And all, some of the structures I've already named, so you can identify them, but they can ask you anything in this image. They can point at anything and ask you. And so what's your answer, guys? It's thyroid membrane, thyrohyoid membrane, isn't it? This thyrohyoid membrane, which goes from the hyoid bone to the thyroid bone. See, this is thyroid cartilage. This already written here, thyroid cartilage. And this bone is the hyoid bone. So this is a thyrohyoid membrane. Very, very important. And clinically, it is important for two reasons. One, as it said, internal laryngeal artery pierces this to enter the larynx. The internal laryngeal nerve is called internal because it has to go inside the larynx. So to enter the larynx inside, it has to pierce something. It pierces this membrane. And the second thing is laryngocele, which is dilation of the saccule, may protrude through this. Because I'm sure you know that laryngocele can be internal laryngocele, external laryngocele. Internal laryngocele remains inside the larynx. It doesn't come out. But external has to come out. And a laryngocele cannot come out through the cartilage. You can see all these are cartilage. This is the only area which is the membrane. So it protrudes through this membrane and becomes external laryngocele. And that's when the patient of laryngocele begins to have a neck swelling. Before that, there is no neck swelling. The only complaint in laryngocele before this is hoarseness of voice. But the moment the hoarseness of voice starts and the neck swelling, then you know that the laryngocele has become external, has protruded through this membrane. Now, very important thing I want to tell you, that superior laryngeal nerve, which is a branch of vagus, superior comes like this nerve, and it divides into two branches. One is external, one is internal. Internal comes and goes inside this and pierces in and goes in the larynx inside. So this is the how the internal goes inside the by piercing this thyroid membrane and becomes internal to supply the sensory to the supraglottic area. Whereas external remains outside, that's why it's called external, and it goes and travels this muscle, which are the cricothyroid muscles. See, these muscles are going from the these are ligaments actually, but the muscle also, the muscle is not shown here. The cricothyroid muscle is supplied by the external laryngeal nerve. So if external is damaged, which is very common in thyroidectomy surgeries, then the cricothyroid is gone and it cannot function. If the superior is damaged, then also cricothyroid is gone, isn't it? Because this external laryngeal nerve is a branch of superior laryngeal nerve, a superior laryngeal nerve. But like the question they give you is, a person had a skull-based surgery, and after the skull-based surgery, the patient begins to have a problem with the cricothyroid muscle. Which nerve is damaged? See, skull base is somewhere up here. In skull base surgery, this nerve cannot be damaged, isn't it? So it has to be superior laryngeal nerve or vagus, even vagus, because this is branch of the vagus. But if they ask you in thyroidectomy, a nerve is damaged causing the same problem, cricothyroid problem, then this cannot be damaged in thyroid surgery, because this much thyroid is here, gland is here, thyroid gland is somewhere here. In the surgery of the thyroid gland, you cannot damage this nerve. So in thyroidectomy, if the nerve is damaged causing cricothyroid problem, then it has to be this nerve external. So both nerve damage can cause the same problem, but at different levels. So depending on what surgery is mentioned, based on that, you must have to answer the question. So that's the trick they use. Surgery of the submandibular gland surgery, and then there's a cricothyroid problem. So submandibular gland means external cannot get damaged. Thyroid surgery, in thyroid surgery, external will get damaged, superior cannot get damaged. That's skull base is mainly vagus. So if you have the same muscle in the larynx, cricothyroid muscle is not functioning. If the surgery is in the skull base, vagus is damaged. If it is in the face, in upper part of the neck, it is superior laryngeal nerve damage. If it is in the thyroid laryngeal area, thyroid area, then external is damaged. All three level, different nerves, but the problem is the same, which is cricothyroid may have problem. So that's how they try to trick you, but it's not a difficult thing. It's very easy. Next one. Again, a larynx question. Now they ask you to identify the arrow marks muscle this time. Because as I said, laryngeal anatomy is very, very important. That's why we teach laryngeal anatomy in great details in ENT. In general anatomy also, they talk a lot about laryngeal anatomy because they ask a lot of questions. In fact, in the recently held INISET exam, the central university exams, there are three questions from the anatomy of the larynx. Three questions. Can you imagine one exam? And there were only 12 or 15 ENT questions, and out of that, three were from the laryngeal anatomy. It's such an important thing. So I'm sure by now you must have been able to identify this muscle. It is cricothyroid muscle. This is a main tensor but weak adductor of the vocal cord. The main function is the tension of the vocal cord, and it's weak adductor also. This is the only laryngeal muscle from the fourth brachial arch. All other muscles of the larynx, they develop from the sixth brachial arch. And this is supplied by the external. Remember, I just told you external laryngeal nerve supplies this muscle and causes the tension. So that's why the patient will have loss of tension. If this nerve is damaged, the patient will have loss of tension. Loss of tension. And so there will be low pitch voice. The patient will have low pitch voice. So that's what I said. Suppose I tell you the patient has a skull-based surgery, and after that, the patient began to have low pitch voice. Or the patient has an upper neck surgery, say submandibular gland surgery, extended, and began to have low pitch voice. Or the patient has thyroidectomy surgery and began to have low pitch voice. That's the problem is the same, low pitch voice. So when there's low pitch voice and loose vocal cord, you know the cricothyroid is gone. And the nerve that supplies the cricothyroid is external. But like I showed here, external can only get damaged when you do a thyroidectomy. But if you do submandibular gland excision, external cannot get damaged because external originates here. So their superior is damaged. And superior comes from the vagus. So in the skull base, the vagus will get damaged. So that's how you have to pick up the nerve. So this is how, as I said, is a trick that they use in the exam. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. This is very, very profound and important. So try to keep this in mind. And let's know the other muscles. This muscle is going from the thyroid to the thyroarytenoid muscle. Thyroarytenoid. This is mainly a tensor, but it also is mainly a adductor. It's also a tensor. This one is PCA, posterior cricoarytenoid. This is the only abductor of the vocal cord, PCA. This is LCA, lateral cricoarytenoid. This is one of the main adductors. Posterior cricoarytenoid is abductor, and the lateral cricoarytenoid is adductor. And this one is interarytenoid. Interarytenoid, they have oblique arytenoid and transverse arytenoid. It's also called transverse arytenoid. And there are fibers which look obliquely, so it can be called oblique interarytenoid also. And this is the only muscle which is single. See, this thyroarytenoid, this one, let me use different color. Thyroarytenoid is left and right two. This cricothyroid is left and right two. Lateral cricoarytenoid is left and right two. Posterior cricoarytenoid is left and right two. But interarytenoid only one, common. It's common to both the sides. And this is the main adductor. Now this is another hack, that when one side nerve is damaged completely, if one side nerve is damaged completely, then all this muscle of the side will go. You cannot have this muscle, this muscle, this muscle, all. But this muscle can still function because it is coming, it is getting the supply from other side also. This is the only muscle of the larynx getting bilateral supply, both the sides, because it's a common nerve muscle from supplying both, running from one side to the other side, interarytenoid at its call. That's why even if one side, all the muscles, all the nerves are gone, you still have an adduction function happening because of this muscle. So that's another point that you can keep in mind. So try to identify these muscles actually. And interarytenoid, I told you, very, very important, because it is supplied by both the nerves. The only muscle of the larynx is supplied by bilateral, has a bilateral supply. So in order to damage this nerve, you have to damage both the nerves, both side nerve. Only then this muscle will stop function. So once again, guys, anatomy of the larynx, spend some time knowing the cartilages, identify the cartilages, then know about cartilages, which paired, unpaired cartilage, the shape of various cartilages, which can get calcified, which cannot get calcified. Then muscles, very important. And also which muscle is supplied, which nerve, what are the function of the muscle. And they can give you the anatomy, image-based question to identify the nerve also. And I've just shown that if you use this image, a similar kind of image, you can identify the nerves also that is going to supply the different muscles of the larynx. So these are some of the anatomy of the laryngeal question. But we'll go on to the next question. This is a audiogram, and just make a diagnosis by looking at the audiogram. What is the disease the patient is having by looking at the audiogram? Think about it. The diagnosis is atherosclerosis. And the finding is described as Cahart's notch. In Cahart's notch, as it says, there is a dip at 2000 Hz frequency in the bony conduction audiogram. So this is a 2000 Hz, and there is a dip. This graph goes suddenly like this, and then it goes like this. So this is called sudden dip at 2000 Hz, and this symbol is the symbol for the bony conduction of the left ear. So it's atherosclerosis of left ear is a more precise diagnosis. Because this particular audiogram, this symbol, which is like this, this stands for BC of left ear. And this is AC of left ear. This is AC of left ear. So AC of left ear is below 25. See, this is the 25 mark here. AC of the left ear is below 25 mark. And the AC, but BC is above the 25. So if AC is below, which is here, and BC is above 25 mark, which is true in this case, both are true, this is diagnostic of conductive hearing loss. And the gap between the two is more than, some books says 15 decibel, some says 20 decibel. So in this case, it is more than 20 definitely. So AB gap is more than 20 decibel, which is also given here. So that's also easy. So this is Cahart's notch and atherosclerosis with conductive hearing loss. If you add this, that it is conductive hearing loss, then the examiner knows that you know the criteria for diagnosing conductive hearing loss in an audiogram. So if I ask once again, what is the criteria for diagnosing conductive hearing loss in audiogram? This is the criteria. AC must be below 25, BC must be above 25, and the gap between the two must be, AB gap must be more than 15 to 20 decibel. And in sensitive hearing loss, both are below 25, AC and BC, and the gap is less than 15. So just the opposite happens in sensory neural hearing loss. Both AC and BC are below 25 mark, and the gap is less than 15, not more than 15. So these are the things, and they can ask you an audiogram-based question. They'll just give you an audiogram and then ask you, is it CHL, SNS, right ear, left ear? So right ear and left ear, you have to know by the image, this symbol, and the color. Blue is, this is blue color, blue is used for left ear, and red is used for right ear, R for right, R for red. That's simple. In right ear, circle is AC of right ear, and opposite of this, this is BC of right ear. Okay. So audiometry is very, very important. Try and learn audiometry as well as tympanometry. Tympanometry also read, because questions are asked from, image based questions are asked from these two conditions. But we'll go on to the next question. This is simple. This was asked last year. So what is the diagnosis? Very simple. It was asked last year. It's rhinophyma. Potato nose, it's called. Rhinophyma, potato nose. Very, very important. It's not a nose problem. It is a skin problem, skin of the nose. There is hypertrophy of the sebaceous gland, of the nasal skin. Hypertrophy of sebaceous gland, of nasal skin, skin of the nose, isn't it? And so it's a cosmetic problem mainly. There's no functional problem. It's a cosmetic disease. From the clinician point of view, if I'm a doctor and the patient comes with problem, if the function of the organ is normal, the nose is functioning normally or the ear is functioning normally, then as a clinician, surgeon, I don't bother. I say your functions are normal. So from my side, everything's okay. You don't require treatment. Cosmetic is a patient's own problem. How the patient wants to look like, this is not my problem. If the patient says, no, I want to look better, this is not suiting me, whatever reason, then of course, you have to go for cosmetic surgery. And cosmetic surgeries have a lot of limitations. In this case, what we do is, we have to remove this whole skin. That's the only option. We have to remove the whole skin, shave of the skin as we call it, and we have to graft the skin from some other part of the body. So shaving the skin and grafting some from the skin from some other part of the body is the main treatment that is required for rhinophyma. But along with rhinophyma, you should be able to identify the image of rhinosporidiosis and rhinoscleroma. In rhinoscleroma and rhinosporidiosis, there's a growth inside the nose. So it's not the skin problem, it's inside the nose. And those are functional problems. Those are more concerning from my point of view, from the clinician's point of view. Rhinoscleroma, as it says, is sclerosis of the nose. So there's sclerosed tissue. And sclerosed tissue is often whitish or pale in color, not very deep red in color. We know sclerosed tissue is a fibrous tissue, which is, fibrous tissue is whitish or pale. So you can make out, and it's very hard to feel. And that's why it's called wood hard nose, or woody nose it's called, wood hard, woody nose, versus potato nose, which is this one. And rhinosporidiosis is a deep red, unlike rhinoscleroma, which is pale, mild red. This is deep red, as if it has been, there's blood inside. It's not blood, but it's like there's blood inside. And so it may bleed a bit. And that's why that rhinosporidiosis is called bleeding polyp. Normal nasal polyps don't bleed. The rhinosporidiosis can bleed. It's called bleeding polyp. And the common expression for rhinosporidiosis is strawberry polyp, because it looks deep red like a strawberry. So that's a strawberry polyp. Rhinoscleroma is woody nose, and rhinophyma is potato nose. So these are the terms. And nasal polyps of the ethmoids are called bunch of grapes. Bunch of grapes, ethmoidal polyp, woody nose, rhinoscleroma, potato nose, rhinophyma, and strawberry polyp is rhinosporidiosis. These are some of the terminologies that you might want to remember when you go for the exam from the nose point of view. These are from the nose point of view. Next one, identify this condition. Again, a very important popular question. You can see this is a child, the mouth is kept open, and look at the face, usually in children the face is roundish. No, when you draw, when you learn drawing of the face, the first thing they'll say, when you draw a child, draw the face round and the eyes are mostly in the center. When you draw an adult, it is more round and the eyes are one third, two third, eyes are here. So that is the one thing they say. If the child has a long face like the adult, it is called long face. This long face is not supposed to be normal for a child. It is normal for adult, not for child. So this is how they ask you to do. So this is a long face and the mouth is open. So I'm sure by now I've given you a lot of hint. You know the answer. It is adenoid faces, isn't it? Due to adenoid hypertrophy. Very common in a child between 5 to 10 years of age. This is due to constantly enlarged adenoid which is not treated. And because the adenoid is enlarged, the nose is blocked. The child cannot breathe from the nose. So the child becomes what is called mouth breather. That's why the mouth is always open, as you can see here. The child is a mouth breather. And the child has to keep the mouth open to breathe. And these are the other features of adenoid faces. And this is important. What are the features of adenoid faces? Adenoid faces have high arch palate, crowded upper teeth, pinched nose, hyperplastic maxilla, and long face, which I just told you. Long face in some books is described as dull expression. Long face and dull expression are same thing. And adenoid faces. So this child will require adenoidectomy surgery. And in most cases, when there's adenoid hypertrophy for such a long period of time, which is leading to adenoid faces, this patient often requires, often have glue ear also, glue ear hearing loss. So grommet insertion may also be required along with adenoidectomy in many of these patients. So they can frame a question around that, that this, which is the other surgery this patient may require. The other surgery this patient may require is grommet insertion. Right. Next one. This is again, relevant in today's time. It's relevant in today's time, otherwise not such an important thing. Just make a diagnosis, look at this face of the patient. There's black colored tissue, skin, and by now you know, because we have taken a lot of sessions related to this disease. Everybody has taken session because it's a very, very important topic, likely to be asked in the exam, in the upcoming exam. And this is what? Come on guys, answer. Black, but diagnosis. Then is diagnosis. Black is okay, but what is the diagnosis? Which fungus? Black fungus. No. Name the name. Name. Black fungus is a layman's term. What is RB? Name the fungus. Black fungus is a wrong name. It's a misnomer. It's a layman's term. Newspaper wale likhte black fungus. TV wale dikhate. Yeah. Dinesh. Mucormycosis. Correct. Yeah, it is mucormycosis with orbital extension. Mucormycosis with orbital. It's called black fungus, as you rightly said. So it starts from the nose and extends to the orbit and the cranial cavity. That's the danger. And amphotericin is the drug of choice. The main drug is amphotericin B. Debridement of the all tissue that you see has to be done. And in case of orbit, orbital excentration has to be done. In case of orbit, orbital excentration has to be done. So in orbit, this is a question, potential question. That if a mucormycosis has spread to the orbit, what do you do? There are two options. You can do decompression of the orbit, decompression, or you can do excentration. And this depends on the severity of the involvement. If it is very mild involvement, the orbit is still normally functioning, there is no ophthalmoplasia, there is no vision defect, and the patient has come in the very early stage, then you can do decompression of the orbit. That's enough. But this patient, like in this case, by now, you see the eye is blocked, closed. This patient definitely has some kind of ophthalmoplasia and diplopia, maybe vision defect also. Then you have to do excentration of the orbit where the eyeball is to be removed. Because we don't want to take chances from the orbit, the infection can go to the cranial cavity. Because mucormycosis is very notorious for orbital spread and cranial spread. And we don't want to take a chance with cranial cavity, and that's why we do this orbital excentration. And let me tell you, in this second wave of COVID, we know that there was this infection was a very, very common problem, rampant around. So we did a lot of excentration of the orbit. Some people had to undergo bilateral orbital excentration. Can you imagine? Both the eyeballs had to be removed, and many of these were young people. Now rest of the life they will have to live without eye. They will have to be blind for rest of the life. very bad, very sad, but that's the reality. That's why this is a important MCQ. Hypertension B, hyperkalemia more common, add KCL. Yeah, we add KCL also, and we also don't give hypertension, we usually mix it with dextrose, glucose, saline, and therefore you have to neutralize the saline with insulin also, because many of these patients are diabetic. This is caused because of either diabetes or steroid. So many of these are diabetic, and you have to give along with the glucose 5D, 5% D, and so you have to neutralize with insulin so that the patient's glucose level does not shoot up, because that can even worsen the condition. Right. X-ray view. This is very important. Very, very important. What X-ray view is this? Extremely important, as I asked last time. Yes, guys. I'm waiting for your answers. No one? Cardwell's view. This is a Cardwell's X-ray view, and it is done for frontal sinus. The best X-ray view for frontal sinus. This anteroposterior view, AP view, as you can see from the whole skull can be seen from the front, as you can see. So it's anteroposterior view. This posaconazole is alternative to amphotericin B. Posaconazole is added where amphotericin B cannot be used for whatever reason. Either the patient has kidney problems, or patient has, because amphotericin B is a nephrotoxic drug, or the patient starts having nephrotoxicity with the help of amphotericin B. And even if you have to continue the antifungal for a long dose of time, 1-2 months, then for that long you cannot give amphotericin B. Amphotericin B is a very good drug, but it's very toxic. So you can give only for 1 week, 2 weeks, just about that. If you have to continue beyond 2-3 weeks, then you consider posaconazole as an alternative drug for mucormycosis. But coming back to this, this is an anteroposterior view. Yes, Yuvraj, you are absolutely right. Anteroposterior view is called Cardwell's view. It is not dead anteroposterior. It is anteroposterior 5 to 15 degree angle. This is angle of between 5 to 15 degrees. And it is the best view for frontal sinus. Yes, guys. So these are the 10 images that I had in mind today. This is first part only. I'm going to take second part and maybe third part also. So we'll have at least one more part two, maybe part three also in coming few days, within maybe this week's, in the new week has started. So by the end of this week, I'll try to take two more sessions of images. So please look out for that, join that, because it's very, very helpful. These are very important. Most of these images have been asked in the past, and some I expect that the important images, they may be asked in the time to come. So with this, I'll take your leave. I thank you for joining. It was a great pleasure teaching you, and wish you all the best for everything, especially this exam which is coming just around the corner. And I'm pretty sure you guys are all decked up for the exam, working very, very hard, because this could be a make or break for you. And because we have had a bad patch in the past because of this pandemic, so by now you're all set to crack this exam. So guys, we'll do it. Just work for it. Everything else is secondary in life. So with that, I take leave. God bless once again. And my name is Dr. Sanjay Gupta. So bye, and take a good, very good care of yourself, but keep studying, and also be safe, because the pandemic is not over yet. In America, we see that cases are rising. India also, recently we have seen slight increase in the cases. So please take a very good care. You cannot fall sick just before the exam, isn't it? Take care, guys.